So graph is nothing but it's a relationship between an independent variable, which we call as x, with a dependent variable, which we normally call as y. Now, many people say, sir, if I write x in terms of y, then x will become dependent and y will become independent. See, it's just a name given to it. Don't be like, too much into the fact that which is the subject of the formula over here. Why we call it as an independent variable is because many a times this kind of relation, even though I've written it as an f, read this not as a function, read it as a relation. Or read it in your mind as if there is a machine, mathematical machine. Okay? Think as if there is a mathematical machine. Okay? Like this, which I'm calling as machine f. Okay? This machine, you feed in x as an input. Okay? And depending upon what is this input, mark the word, depending upon what is this input, you get an output. Correct? That is why we call y as a dependent variable and x as an independent variable. Yes. Shashwat. See, you may write some of the points. That is fine. But don't be like, busy writing and you're missing out what I'm saying. Okay? It is put on record and PDF will also be shared with you. Okay? So pay attention to whatever is going on. Okay? So what we do is, when we are plotting such kind of a relation, or we are plotting some kind of the dependency of these two variables with each other on a graph, that is what we call as the on the xy axis, that is what we call as a graph. So what we do is, we normally plot the output, okay, along the y axis and the input along the x axis. Okay, and this plane is called a R square plane. Okay, now what is this R written with a double stroke? Many people are getting confused. Okay, this actually is a representation for real numbers. Okay, normally there is a single stroke R also, but we use this for relation. Okay, you'll soon study a chapter in 11th called relations and functions. So there also you'll come across R. So in order to distinguish between the two R's, I have put a double stroke for this to signify real, and one single stroke R will be for relation. Now, what is an R square plane? It's a two-dimension plane which says along both the dimensions, okay, along both the dimensions, you will have real numbers. So basically, X and Y both will be real in character. That means I'm only learning to plot those relations where my input and output both are real numbers. Now, many people ask me, sir, there are complex numbers also. We can also put complex numbers into some kind of machine and get some output. Definitely you can, but those are not going to be plotted on this plane, which we call as the Cartesian plane. Okay? Cartesian plane is a name which is given after the famous French mathematician, René Descartes. The pronunciation is this. The spelling is René. It is written as Descartes, but pronounced as Descartes. Guys, be very, very, spot on with your pronunciation. Tomorrow you are going to appear for an interview in KVPY. Right? I'm sure you are going to clear written down. So there, when the professor is talking to you, you cannot use wrong pronunciation. They will get completely pissed off with the wrong pronunciation, right? There's something called, some people in, yeah. How do you pronounce this? How do you pronounce this? People call it format. It's not format, it's forma. There's something called, you'll come across this soon in your limits chapter. How do you pronounce it? It's not El Hospital. It's L'Hôpital. Yeah, it's French.
It's French.
Yes. There's something called, René Descartes. Okay. So these are the pronunciations that you will be, people will try making opinion about you. Okay. In the interview. So don't mispronounce all these things. Yeah. So basically I'll be plotting only those functions which will take real input and which will give you real output. Those functions I'm going to plot on this Cartesian plane. And those functions will be called as the real valued functions. I will write it down. They are called the real valued functions. Okay. So whatever function chapter you'll be having, in your class 11th, for that matter in class 12th also you have functions chapter. We'll be mostly talking about real valued functions. What are real valued functions? I'm again repeating. The functions which take in real input and give out real output. Is that fine? By the way, you'll come to know little later on in our maths curriculum, this input belongs to a set which we call as domain. Okay. So if you hear this word from me accidentally, don't be like, oh my God, what did sir say? I don't understand what he said. Domain is a set from where you choose your inputs. Okay. That means this machine may not work for every real number. Right? There may be some inputs which will not work in this machine. For example, let's say I make a machine called 1 by X. Right? See, just for you to understand in layman terms, I'm using this word machine. Probably don't find this, you will not find this word in books. Okay? So, did you see the first code that I have put on my, the first slide? Math is to make things easy for you, not difficult. No. It's not to do with ordered pairs. I'll come to ordered pairs a little later on in our course. Think as if you are choosing your inputs from a given basket. That basket is called the domain basket. Okay. For example, in this, I can put everything, but I cannot put zero. Why cannot put zero? It will become undefined. So that basket will contain all real numbers except zero. Okay. So this becomes the domain of the function. Right, from a given set where you choose your inputs, that is called the domain in plain and simple words. So when you're drawing a function, let me tell you all the x values that you are having in the span of that function, that will be a part of the domain. For example, let's say I may end up getting a graph of some function like this. Let's say hypothetically there's a function. So this function, I'm drawing it only between A and B. So your domain is all real numbers between A and B. That means left to A, right to B, you cannot put anything in the machine. The machine doesn't know how to process those inputs. Correct? Will you ever put your shoes inside a microwave? No, right? It is not meant to process, it is not meant to heat up your shoes, right? It is only meant to heat up food items. So shoes is not a part of the input to your microwave. So microwave is a machine. Right? What we can put inside? That is the domain inputs. Getting my point? Whatever you get is called the range. Okay. As of now,
don't. Question.
Yes, sir. Tell me.
Yeah. So is it the inputs which are individual inputs which are called the domain, or the full set which is called the domain?
Full set is called the domain.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So input is chosen from that basket which you call as the domain, or the set which you call as the domain. Okay, so this is a domain where all real numbers except zero are invited to be put in the machine. Correct? And whatever you achieve out of it, that is part of another basket. And that is called the range. That is called the range. Now, there are other things also involved, codomain and all. But right now, don't worry about it. The bridge course agenda is only to make you aware of all the tools. Achha, I forgot one important thing. I think I skipped that slide. Agenda for the bridge course. Okay, so this is the agenda for the bridge course. Sorry, I missed this out. I'll just take 2 minutes and explain this. Sorry to put that topic under hold. See, bridge course is basically designed for a month. So we are closing on May 1st to May 14th. And till that, we'll run this bridge course. The idea is to basically equip you with all the tools and skill sets which you need to immediately face your school. Okay. In fact, immediately to face your, J level of problems or CET level of problems, whatever. See, what will happen when you go to school, two different teachers will be teaching you. Okay. Most probably. It happens in NPS HSR. So, probably in Yashwantpur also, it might be happening. So now, they will not teach you everything, but they will expect you to know these concepts. In fact, I do not blame anybody for it. It's actually the magnitude of the syllabus that they will not teach you about very basics of things. Okay. So I have ensured that before the school reopens, you are introduced to these chapters. One is the graphs, which I'm doing today, and probably I'll do it the next class. I'll try to see whether I'm able to finish it. I have planned for 7 hours under this, but I don't think so. 7 hours will do justice to it. It may run to more. Okay. It will include graphs of various types of functions: algebraic, trigonometric, logarithmic, exponential, modulus, floor function, fractional part, ceiling function. And not only those, we'll also talk about some basic transformations on these graphs. Okay. So what are the, you know, transformations these graphs undergo, right? So that we can plot a complicated graph made out of the same function. Now, most of the things you would not be knowing right now. So just be patient during the course. We'll tell you most of the things. The next topic that we are going to take is calculus. Okay. You'll require calculus immediately in physics. I think you haven't had a session on physics so far, but I'm sure Dheeraj sir is going to start with vectors, I guess. And you'll also start learning calculus there, applying calculus. So calculus is basically, yes, Charan, this PRMO training will happen separately. It's not a part of this course. Okay. So that training is separate. So people who are preparing for PRMO, RMO, there is a separate batch for that. I'll be conducting sessions. In fact, Tushar sir and me will be conducting sessions together for that. You can enroll separately. You can join separately for that. Okay. Yeah. So basic of calculus will be introduced to you so that you know what is this maths, vertical of maths all about. See, calculus is a modern day mathematics concept. Okay. It started with geometry. Then we went to analytical geometry, which we call as the coordinate geometry. Then algebra came into picture, where we started dealing with equations. And slowly now we are moving towards calculus. Okay. Calculus is a science, or you can say a mathematical science, which deals with continuously changing quantities. Okay. And most of the quantities that you will come across in your day-to-day life are continuously changing. Aren't you continuously growing? Correct. Am I not continuously becoming fatter? Just a joke here. Okay. Everything is continuously changing. And how to study those changes is what calculus teaches you. Class 12th, 70% of the topics are calculus based. 70%. Let me write it in yellow. 70% topics of class 12th is based on calculus. And I don't mind speaking over the camera, but let me tell you, CBSE curriculum is, in fact, any curriculum in India is very badly designed. Okay. Let a CBSE secretary or board secretary hear this. There is no logical flow of topics between different verticals. Physics, you start vectors in class 11th. Maths vectors is in class 12th. Physics, you start using calculus. Maths calculus comes in the last few months of 11th. There is so much of disparity. There is so much of disconnection between subjects. Go and see the international books. They are so beautifully designed. I'm also a teacher for A-levels, A and IB. The way they have carried out the flow is superb. But in India, what do? Board exam, syllabus should be light. 11th syllabus should be heavy. Right? Just to make board exam syllabus light, there has been a illogical sequencing of chapters. Okay. In fact, if some of you go and, you know, have a later on, if occupy a good position in bureaucracy, please remember a sincere request from a teacher, make some change. Okay. Even we requested, but nothing is happening. Okay. The last chapter would be a miscellaneous content where we'll be talking about some important tools like determinants, quadratic inequations and inequations. Okay. This is actually a miscellaneous topic. So let's see if time permits, we'll be able to do that. One more request, guys. Whenever you're answering to something, make sure you're using the private this thing. So you can communicate only with the faculty member. So I'll do one thing. I'll make this only with the host. Okay. So if you're speaking something, that is only with me. Okay. Well, so coming back to graphs. So what do I mean by this particular thing is that this function is only allowed to accept inputs from A to B. So this entire values is called the domain. Okay. And the graph span along the y-axis, let's say from here to here. Okay. This span is basically what we call as the range. Okay. So if somebody says, what's the domain of this function graph that you have plot? You should see on the x-axis. From where to where is your graph spanning? That span is called the domain. If you see along the y-axis, from where to where the graph is spanning, that is called the range of the function. Okay. Don't worry too much about it. Separate chapter is devoted to it. I'll talk about it. So what are we going to learn, my dear friends, here is to first draw algebraic graphs or graphs of functions which are algebraic in nature. Okay. Now, before I go to algebraic graphs, there is a small, in fact, under the algebraic graphs, we'll talk about first the graphs of polynomial functions. Now, I should not be using the word functions right now because you don't know officially what's a function. Think as if it's a relation. Okay. But before that, I would like you all to tell me, what's a polynomial? What is a polynomial? Who will unmute himself and explain what is a polynomial?
Sir, it's an algebraic expression with a degree not in fractions nor in decimals.
Okay, not only degree, but also
the whole all the terms in the polynomial, all the terms in the algebraic expression has to have a degree only in natural numbers, whole numbers. I'm sorry.
Yes, yes. Very good, Charan. So what basically Charan said that a polynomial is a expression. Now mark my words. As I told you, you will be judged on the way you are going to use these terms. So polynomial is an expression in single variable. You cannot have two variables in a polynomial. So either you use X or you use Y or you use T or you use any 26 alphabets. Okay. It should be in a single variable. And its structure should be like this. Let's say I'm using a variable X. That's why I'm using the word P of X. Just to, you know, write something like F of X. Okay. P for polynomial. X because I'm using X as my variable. So a polynomial basically is something which looks like this. It should have the same structure that I'm writing over here. Okay. Where none of these powers that you see on this variable must be negative integers. If nothing is there, you can write zero also. These powers should only be whole numbers. They should not be negative integers. They should not be fractions. Correct? So these powers, or you can say the index of the variables, okay, should only be belonging to whole numbers. Okay? So two things to be noted. It should have this structure. There should not be any deviance from this structure. And none of the powers should be negative integer or fraction. It can only be whole numbers. It can only be non-negative integers, so as to say. Okay? Take some example. Let us say x cube minus 3x square plus 4. Is it a polynomial? Is it a polynomial? Yes. Because its structure is matching with this. And moreover, none of the powers are fractions. None of the powers are negative integers. Everything is a whole number. Okay. So this is a polynomial. But is this a polynomial 1 by x cube minus 3x square plus 4? Is it a polynomial? No. It's a rational function, but it is not a polynomial. You cannot call it as a polynomial. Polynomials are types of rational functions. Now, what is a rational function? Somebody asked me in the previous class. See, rational functions are basically functions of the nature a polynomial by another polynomial. Okay. So it's a ratio of two polynomials, you can say. Okay, so this is a rational function, but not a polynomial. And all polynomials are rational functions. Getting my point? So this is not a polynomial because its structure is not the same as what I have mentioned. Okay, acha, tell me this one. X to the power 3 by 2 plus 6x plus 5. Is it a polynomial? Is it a polynomial? No, it is not a polynomial. The reason is it has got a fractional power. Okay. Now, what is the degree of a polynomial? So, degree of the polynomial is defined as the highest index or the highest index occurring in that given expression. So, here your degree is n. And that is subject to the fact that the leading coefficient is not zero. Okay. This is, yes, highest power present in that expression. Provided this term, guys, I'll be talking a lot about this term today. This term is called leading coefficient. What it is called? Leading coefficient. Because it leads the way like a leader. Okay. Now, I'm not joking. Yes, it definitely leads the way the graph looks. Okay. I'll explain you in some time why it is called a leading coefficient and how it leads the way.
Excuse me, sir. One doubt.
Yes, sir.
Sir, yeah, this leading coefficient, sir.
Yeah.
So, this leading coefficient, does it only come as a coefficient for the highest number that which the variable which consists the degree of the polynomial or the first coefficient found in any any polynomial?
It is the coefficient of the highest index term.
Okay.
That is called the leading coefficient. Okay. Even if you write it ulta, let's say, Charan, I write it like this.
Okay.
E minus 3x plus 2x squared. This will be the leading coefficient. It doesn't mean it is coming first or last. It is the coefficient. Now, he used the word coefficient. I'll tell you, everybody. These numbers are called the coefficients. Okay. Out of these coefficients, the first one, which is present with the highest power, that is called the leading coefficient. Is that fine? Okay. Now, just a quick question for everybody. Just a quick question for everybody. What is the degree of, quick question. What is the degree of a polynomial 6? What will you say? Type privately to me. Everybody, please. 6. What is the degree? Oh my God, I'm getting various responses. All the way from somebody who is saying 6, from 1, from 0. Okay. Some of you, oh, it's not a polynomial. Okay, I'm getting various responses. Now, here comes some kind of unlearning and relearning. Guys, let me tell you one important thing which I wanted to tell you. There are many things which you have not learned correctly in 10th. And that is not because of mistake of yours. Okay, you're going to unlearn them and relearn them. Okay, so be prepared to unlearn certain things. Now, this is actually a polynomial. Okay, so people who are saying, doubting that it's polynomial or not, let me tell you, it's a polynomial and its degree is zero. Okay, because you can only express it as 6x to the power 0, so degree has to be zero. But now my follow-up question is, what if I have zero itself? Right? Is it a polynomial and what is the degree of the polynomial? Okay. Hariharan, Tanishka, Madhav, Arjun, Charan, Andy. Okay. Not a polynomial. Okay. 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 Now here comes the verdict, my dear. Yes, it is a polynomial, but its degree is not defined. So Charan was absolutely correct. Because when you write 0, you can write it along with any power. I can write power of 2, I can write power of 6, I can write power of 100, I can write power of 1 lakh. It will work with any power. That's why we say, even though it's a polynomial, the degree is not defined. No. Infinity is a different thing altogether, Shashwat. Now, that's something which is again, part and parcel of this bridge course. There's a difference between the word not defined and infinity. Okay. What is the difference between not defined and infinity? Not defined means that operation is not mathematically possible. Right? So this is not a legal operation in maths. For example, 1 by 0. Right? You cannot perform such an operation. That's why we say this is an undefined operation in maths. But when you write 1 divided by a quantity x, where x is very, very small on the positive side, we say, or you can say some constant divided by x, where x is approaching towards a very, very small positive value, then we say this takes a very, very large value, and that large value is a value which is too big to represent, so we use infinity symbol for that. But this operation is a legal operation, right? Even though the result is too big to manage, that is still a legal operation. Okay. Yes, I've used limits concept, my dear. So I'll be talking about this in the limits chapter, which is your basics of calculus. Don't worry. Let's have patience. Okay. So I'm going to begin with the basics of all polynomial. Not the constants. I know you know constants. By the way, I'll just revise this also. Constants. How do you plot a constants? So if I ask you, represent this graph, y is equal to 2. What do you do for that? What do you do for that? What does it mean actually? There is no independent variable over here. Everything is, you know, just a constant, right? What does it mean? It means that whatever you put in this function is always going to throw out 2 at you. Correct? So if you plot this, or if you show a diagrammatic representation of a machine which does this activity, you will represent it by a parallel horizontal line. You can say a line parallel to the x-axis, which will always be having y value as 2. That means it will cut the y-axis at 0, 2. And this is how you represent it. Okay. Ensure that whenever you are making a line, you put arrows at the ends. That so shows that the graph is moving indefinitely to both the sides. Okay. So just to ask you a simple question. What is the domain of this function, my dear? Anybody? Domain of this function? How do you represent everything in maths? Didn't I tell you it's a R square plane? All right. It's all real numbers. Very good. Aditya, Hariharan, very good. Acha, one more question I'll ask. What is the range of this function? Right. You'll say it's a set which only contains 2. Okay. Don't worry, sets is also a chapter. We'll come to it. Okay. So I'm not going to talk about constant graphs. You already know it. I'm going to directly jump, my dear, to linear graphs, or graphs of linear polynomials. I should not say linear polynomial. I should say linear functions. Okay. Okay. Linear function graphs. So I'll start with the very basic one, which is y is equal to, let's say, x plus 2. Okay, let's say y equal to 3x plus 2. Okay, now how many of you have been introduced to lines in class 10th? Okay, I'll again run a poll. Poll is type yes if you have been introduced to lines before, type no if you don't know lines at all. At least the basic equation, graph, concept of slope, intercept. Wonderful. Everybody, please vote. Everybody, please vote. At the count of 5, I'll stop the voting. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, stop. Okay. So 23 of you have voted. Out of that, 18 of you have said, I know it. 5 of you say, I don't know it. Okay. Never mind. I'll go by the very basics. See, this is something which we call as a linear graph. Now, this name has come because of the fact that this graph, the graph of such functions is a line, just like this. This is actually also a linear graph. You can attach a 0x to it. Okay. So this is a line. This is a graph of a geometrical structure, which we call as a line. And that's why it gets its name as a linear graph. Okay. Now here, many people know how to plot it. Okay. people who don't know how to plot it, I'll discuss with you how to plot a function in a slightly unique way. Okay, you will not have heard of this method before. I always start my graph with the constant term. So what I'll do is, all of you please pay attention. I will make a coordinate axis. So basically x in the y axis. All of you please pay attention. I always start with the constant term 2. Okay. So I express 0, 2 on this graph. That means I will get a structure, or I will get a curve which will be hinged to 0, 2. Hinged means attached to 0, 2. Okay. Next, what I do is I introduce the next term 3x. So see, I'm coming from constant side. So slowly after constant, I have brought the 3x term. Okay. Now this 3x term actually makes the graph depend on x, because now x has made its appearance. Okay. Now the leading coefficient here is 3. 3 is your leading coefficient. Okay. All of you please pay attention. I know most of you know that 3 is also the slope. I'll come to that little later on. Just listen to me. So because of this 3x, my dear, it gives a linear dimension to the graph. That means my graph will start becoming like a line hinged to 0, 2. Now this line can either be like this. This line can either be like this. Right? It can be so many ways. It can be either be like this. Let me choose a different color. It could be either be like this blue one. Okay. It could be either be like this red one. Okay. Now, how do I identify that because of this 3x, what is the direction that the line is going to take? Who is going to lead the way? That's the leading coefficient. I was talking about leading coefficient leading the way. So that's the leading coefficient, which actually gives me an idea where the graph is heading towards. Okay. I know for sure it is passing through 0, 2, but where is it heading to? Only the leading coefficient will show me the way. How? Let's see. Now, if you see here, if the leading coefficient is positive, if this leading coefficient is positive, so this 3 is a positive number, right? It tells you that if you increase your x, let's say if I increase my x, okay, constant is not going to, you know, contribute. If x increases, will y increase or decrease? Simple question. If x increases, will y increase or decrease? No, it's not a hit and trial. I'm going to tell you a very, very, you know, logical way. It's going to increase, correct? Very good. Now, it's because thanks to this leading coefficient, I'm thankful to the leading coefficient for telling me that x will increase when y will increase when x will increase, correct? So it tells me that, boss, this cannot be my answer. These red graph, neither this white graph, these cannot be my answer. Why these cannot be my answer? Because for these graphs, as x is increasing, y is falling down. See, it was like this, right? So if you increase along x, y is falling down. Are you able to see my hand on the screen? Okay. Guys, in today's class, I'll keep on dancing on the camera, okay? So please excuse me for that, because I always love to teach in a physical class. So this technology, even though it is helping me to reach out to you in this corona crisis, is actually, you know, curtailing my attempts. Okay. So the blue graph and the yellow graph are the only two options which is left to me. Now, which of the two graphs I should choose? Again, that's a dilemma. Now, that is also going to be rectified thanks to this leading coefficient. See how. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to increase my x with a delta x. Okay? What is delta x? What is delta x? Anybody? Change in x.
The rate change.
It's not a rate. Don't use the word rate. Again, wrong use of terminology. It's the change in x. Okay. Rate means divided by change in time. That will be rate. Dx by dt, if I do, then you'll say rate of change of x. Okay. Just like rate of change of displacement. That's called velocity. Right. Rate of change of velocity is called acceleration. Anybody knows rate of change of acceleration also? Jerk. Very good. Okay. Very good. Now, jerk may not be a very good word to use. Okay, anyways. So this basically is telling you that if I change my x by delta x, that means, let's say I'm somewhere on this graph. Okay, I'm just going to, you know, extend this line. Okay, let's say I'm somewhere on this graph with some x comma y on it. What is graph? Graph is basically set of all points which are satisfied by that relation, isn't it? That's what is graph, right? Nothing else. So let's say x comma y is such a point which satisfies that given equation. Let me take 1 comma 5 for your convenience. Okay, now if I change my x, if I change my x and come to del x plus delta x, let's say I come to x plus delta x, and this will also bring a change in the y. So I'll come to this position, x plus delta x and y plus delta y. Hope you can see this. Okay, so this is what we call as change in x. This is what we call as change in y. So if you move from point A to point B on the line, there would be some change in the x value to reach the point B, and there will also be a change in the y value, isn't it? Okay, so this change is what we can come to know from this leading coefficient. See how. So even x plus delta x and y plus delta y will satisfy the same relation. Yes or no? Subtract these two. So let me call it as 1. Let me call this 2. Okay. Do 2 minus 1. What does it give me? Tell me on the left hand side, I will get. Oh, I'm so sorry. This is y. Sorry, slip of pen. This is y. So if you subtract it, you'll get a delta y. Correct? If you subtract 3x and one of the 3x goes, you'll get 3 delta x. Correct? 2 and 2 will get cancelled. So I'm left with this relation, which tells you a very, very important thing. It tells you that if you're moving along that line, the ratio of the change in y to change in x is 3. What does it mean? It means that for every 1 unit change in x, the y is changing by 3 units. 3 times change it is experiencing. That means its steepness should be more. Are you getting my point? So it's like you are walking 1 kilometer in this direction. It is raising you by 3 kilometers. Right? That's why this leading coefficient 3 here actually works as the slope of the line. Yes, Swaraj, it's the slope of the line. We also call it in the language of calculus as the gradient. Okay? Gradient and slope both are the same thing. Okay. Now, if there is no change in y when there is a change in x, what we say gradient is 0. For example, x-axis. If I go, x-axis is also a line, no? At the end of the day, it's also a line. So let's say if I move from x comma y to a point x plus delta x, there is no change in the y. Isn't it flat? So no, the slope is 0. The gradient is 0. If there is infinite change in y with respect to a small change in x, we are basically walking along the vertical direction almost. Okay. And that's why we say, sorry, let me write it over here. That's why we say slope of x axis is tending to 0 and slope of y axis is tending to infinity. Now, many people ask me, sir, why you say tending to 0 and tending to infinity? See, when you say slope, basically, it is with respect to some reference. You cannot tell the slope of line with itself. You have to treat something else as a reference. So here, when I'm saying I'm treating x-axis as a line, normally, and I'm treating x-axis itself as a reference. So I should say this change or this particular, I would say, a deviance in the choices is represented by tending to 0. Okay, later on you will learn something about product of slopes being equal to minus 1 when they are perpendicular. There you will realize why I use the word tending to 0. Whereas y-axis has a very, very large slope. Right? Yeah, Akshay, I think that answers your question. What is tending? Tending means going very close to 0 but not achieving 0. Even though for practical purpose, while solving questions, you can safely assume the slope to be 0 for an x-axis. But in reality, it is very, very small. Okay. So yeah, somebody is raising the hand. Anybody, any question? Okay. Guys, please feel free to stop me at any time where you want some kind of clarification. Very good. Okay. So this three that you have seen, which is actually your leading coefficient, was also your slope. Okay. Now something very interesting. If you have a line in this way, they will always be called as a positive slope line because there is an increase in y with the increase in x. If the line is in this way, we call it as a negative slope line because with the decrease in x, there is an increase in y. Okay. If let's say if you increase your slope, it will become more vertical in nature. It will become more steep in nature. The moment it becomes parallel to the y-axis, we say that the slope is infinity, right? That doesn't mean that if you're coming from negative side, in order to become y-axis, your slope has to be negative infinity. No, it is still called infinity, right? So many people, you know, ask me this question, sir, is plus infinity and minus infinity meeting each other? You may say so, okay? Especially for a graph which is following a linear characteristic. Okay, so now here, try to understand, when your graph becomes more negative in slope, it is going to start tilting this way. Hope you are able to see the motion of my hand on your video. The moment it becomes here, we still say the slope is tending to infinity. Okay, we don't use the word minus infinity in this case. Which part you did not understand, Arnav? See, actually what happens, I'll show you in the next graph. Let's say I have a line like this. Let me show it in gray color. I have a line like this, okay? Now this has a negative slope. Let's say the slope here is minus 4, okay? What is the meaning of minus 4 slope? So if there is a 1 unit change in x, there would be a 4 units change in y, okay? If I start tilting this line in this way, let's say I now tilt it like this, the slope will become more negative. That means, let's say it would become, let's say, minus 10. Correct? So if I keep on more increasing, let's say I choose now this orange one, like this, okay? Here you probably will have a slope of, let's say, minus 1000, okay? If you keep doing that, ultimately when it becomes vertical, that means like this, vertical, parallel to the y-axis, will you say the slope has become minus infinity? Actually, we never use this word. Even though you are logically going more negative, but ultimately when it becomes y-axis, we say it is tending towards infinity only because there is no direction of a line, right? Even if I had gone, more positive, I would have reached the same position, right? Even if I would have gone negative more, I would have reached the same position, okay? So we don't use the word negative infinity slope. Positive infinity or tending to zero is what we can use. I'm talking about lines, not talking about quadratic equations. Okay. And that too, you're talking about gradient, Hariharan. Okay. Yes, there are negative infinity words used. I'm not saying you can never use negative infinity, but not for the slope of a line. Okay. Hope I have clarified myself. So it tells you one thing, that this number that you see signifies where it is basically cutting the y-axis. That's why we call it as the y-intercept. This number basically signifies the slope, which gives you a rough estimation of how much is the line inclined and which way, this way or this way. Okay. Now I would like you to take up these two questions, everybody. Okay. On your notebook, now time to open up your notebook and do a sketching of this graph. Now, what is the meaning of sketch? People ask me, how is sketch and plotting different? Sketch means rough estimation. Okay? You have to give a rough estimation of the graph. Right? Plotting means exact point by point. So, for plotting, you would need a graph sheet. For sketching, you would not need a graph sheet. So, I am assuming that you are sitting with your notebook. Just a pen you could have. If there is a scale, it will be helpful, but even scale is not required. Okay. Now I would like you to sketch the following graph. Y is equal to minus half x plus 3 y is equal to, let's say, 5x minus 2. Well, let's say I keep the last term as my plus 3 always. And I would ask you to plot y is equal to minus 6x plus 3. Okay. On the very same graph, I would like you all to draw these three figures for me quickly. Can I just have 90 seconds for this? Not more than that. Time starts now. Let me know once you're done. Guys, I want rough. Please do not sit and start making calibrations on the x-axis and the y-axis. Roughly. That's why I asked you to make it on the same graph so that I know that you are understanding the relative slopes and all. Now, I may ask somebody to scribble on the screen. Hope you know how to use your annotation tool. Okay, there is an annotation tool on the Zoom platform by which you can also scribble on my screen. Okay, but please do not misuse it. Don't start scribbling on the screen because I can come to know who is scribbling. So I'll name a person and that person only will scribble. Yeah, there is a pen kind of a structure. I'm sure you can see it in, I don't know what you are seeing on your screen, but on my screen, it is appearing like a pen. Okay. Annotate. It is written annotate there. Akshay, did you figure that out? Annotate. Anybody who has seen it, can you guide Akshay? Okay, let me just put it for everybody to communicate. Yeah. Akshay, you found it? No, Anurag found it. I don't think it's here. Okay. Never mind. So only those people who can see the annotate, they will be under scrutiny. Yeah, there's a pencil button in the screen. Plot it anywhere. No, just let's say I call this as 0,3. Okay, rough estimation. Okay, not very accurate. Okay, so let's say this is my 0,3. Yeah, if you're using a mobile phone, then you can see it as a pen coming up on top. Okay, anyways, I will do one graph for you. And relative to that, you have to show me the other two graphs. Okay, so I'll just draw the first one for you. It's a graph with a negative slope. That means it should go this way. And half signifies that the change in y is one half the change in x. So it is not very high negative. So you can say somewhat like this. Achha, by the way, guys, there is something which I wanted to discuss. When you say slope, okay, slope of a line is basically the rise over run, isn't it? So slope is nothing but it's the change in y by change in x. Okay. Now this change is basically represented by an angle. So in this case, the angle is basically, let me just extend this a little bit more. Basically, this is the angle by which we represent something which we call as the angle of inclination. Angle of inclination. I'll talk about it in the straight line chapter. What is this angle of inclination? It is basically the positive angle. It is defined as the positive angle. Please make a note of it if you want. It's a positive angle between the x-axis and the given line. Okay, that is called the angle of inclination of a line. Okay, and this angle has to be measured starting from the x-axis. Angle has to be measured starting from the x-axis. Okay. Now, what is it? I'll explain you in this diagram. So if you start from x-axis and go in a positive direction, now this is something which is may not be known to you. There's something called positive angle. What's the positive angle? Anybody knows it? Anybody knows what's the positive angle? In maths, there's something called positive angle. Absolutely, Madhav. Absolutely. Angle measured in anti-clockwise is called positive angle. See, what is an angle? Angle is basically a mathematical parameter which is trapped between two rays. Let's say this is a ray which is initial position and this ray moves to a terminal position like this. This trapped parameter here will be called as an angle. Okay. Now, if this movement is happening anti-clockwise, we say this is a positive angle. So let's say my angle, my ray was like this first. If I moved like this, then this angle which is transverse by this ray will be called as a positive angle. Okay. If you go this way, that means from this position to this position, if you go. So this is your initial position and this is your terminal position. Then this angle will be called as a negative angle. So this will be a negative angle in maths. Okay. So angle measured in anti-clockwise sense is positive. Angle measured in clockwise sense is negative. Okay. So when I'm starting from x-axis and going in an anti-clockwise way to hit the line, then this angle will be a positive angle, which we call as the angle of inclination. Okay. Now this angle of inclination tan is what we call as the slope. As of now, it's just important to know this. I'll be talking more on it in the lines chapter. Meanwhile, people who have learned how to annotate, who is going to come up and do the second one? Anybody? Charan, would you like to try it here? Show on the same graph. Okay, by the way, I have missed out. This is now my 0,3. Okay, let me assume this to be 0,3. Yeah, doesn't matter. Yeah, can you show me on the same graph how would 5x plus 3 look like? Vedha Smita, I would request you to unmute yourself because I have not understood your question.
Sir, I just want to know how, like, you just extend the line from the x point, from the y axis to any point in the x axis.
A line is an infinitely extending figure, so it's not about from one point. It can pass through. See, what's the line? Line is basically, it's an infinitely extending figure, which actually goes from one point to another without any change in the direction. Okay. So you can draw a line from anywhere to anywhere. Getting my point? You can draw it from anywhere to anywhere. So what's your actual question?
No, sir, to draw the slope, How do you plot the rise and the run? And
No, I don't draw the slope, dear. I don't draw the line. Slope is calculated for that line.
Okay.
For example, there is something which Charan has done. Charan, this is not correct, dear. See, it is a positive slope. Right, I'll tell you, it's a positively sloped line. That means, see, your line is saying that as x increases, okay, y is decreasing. Is that the case with second question? No, dear. X is increasing, y is also increasing. Okay, now this is something for Vidha Smita. Please pay attention, dear, here. I'll give the answer to your question through this example. So right now, this is not the right answer. So can you just erase it? Can you just erase it, Charan? Or I will also erase it. No worries. I have the wherewithal. Okay, thank you so much. Now, this is a line which will pass through 0,3 only. And since this 5, so we don't plot the 5 thing. It actually gives you an estimate of what is the steepness of this line. How steep it is. Okay. So plotting is only for a line only. So let's say I draw this line. And I'll draw it at a very high slope of 5. 5 means if there is a change of 1, let's say I erase this part, I light it down again somewhere else. Okay. It means that if I change my x by 1 unit, there will be a change of 5 units in this graph. This is how you figure out from the graph. Okay. You don't draw a slope anywhere.
Okay,
so slope is a characteristic. It is not some. It is not a graph.
Yeah. Okay.
So you can make a sketch of a person. Okay, but when you are mentioning its features, you show that feature in that sketch. For example, if you want to make somebody tall, so you make the graph of the person or sketch of a person and show him tall in that graph. So tallness is not what you're sketching. You're depicting it in the picture. You're sketching the person image. So in the same way, line is what you're sketching. And with what slope is what this number 5 tells you. So this is your slope that leading coefficient tells you. Okay. Who will go for third one? Somebody other than Charan. Just type me if you want to go for the third one. Anybody? Okay, Akshaj, go for it. By the way, 6 o'clock, I'll give you a break. Akshaj, go for it. Go for it. Let's see. Wonderful. Even your line is a little bit crooked, but I understood your intention, dear. It's absolutely correct. It should be a negatively high sloped. Okay. So see, half is like this, no? So it should be somewhere more inclined than this. So half is like this. So the answer should be somewhat more inclined than this. So he has drawn a line perfect. And I'm just trying to show it on the line. So if this is 1, then this will be 6. Okay. And there is a decrease in the value of y with the increase in x and vice versa. So if I'm going this side, decrease in x, there's an increase in y. So it is a negatively sloped line. Are you getting my point? So he has not drawn the slope. He has drawn the line with that given slope. Okay. And never mind. It's okay. So I will draw it for him. So I'll just clear the annotation. Thank you so much, Akshay. That's absolutely correct. So you are going to draw a line like this. I'm taking a different marker color. So let me take gray. Okay, so it would be a line like this, passing through the very same point, and ensure you have put arrows at the end. Is that fine? So with this, I think there is no doubt whatsoever regarding the graph of a linear function. Yes, any question here?
Yeah, sir, I have a doubt about this graph. I didn't know how to draw negative. Yeah, can you just explain me the negative line drawing logic again?
Negative. See, it's very simple. Charan was the person, right? See, Charan, positive slope lines will be like this. Hope you can see the motion of my hand. Okay. Negative slope lines will be like this. See, how do you identify whether it is this or whether it is this? See, if it is this, it means as x grows, y will also grow. Correct? If it is like this, it shows if x reduces, then y will grow. Getting it?
Okay.
So if there is, see, okay, what is the slope? Slope is the ratio of delta y by delta x. So if this guy increases, if this is increase means positive, then this should also be positive. Okay. Then the slope will be positive. But if ulta happens, that this fellow reduces when this fellow increases, then it will be a negative slope line.
Okay. Okay, sir. Fine. That's
okay. So,
sir, I have one doubt.
Yes, yes.
If x is heading towards left side, yes, is it increasing or decreasing?
It's decreasing. In this side, if you're going, you're reducing. If this side you are going, delta x is increasing. If you are going up, y is increasing. If you are going down, y is decreasing.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
What's the point? Okay. See, line extends infinitesimally. Okay. It goes from one end to other infinitely. Okay. It doesn't stop. So it doesn't matter if you are going from A to B or coming from B to A, you will experience the same sign of the change. So let's say if I'm going from A to B, there'll be positive change here. There'll be positive change here also. That means the ratio will still be a positive number. See here. If I'm going from B to A, there will be decrease in Y also, there will be decrease in X also. That means still negative by negative will give you a positive. Is that fine? Okay. So what I'll do is I'll take a break. All of you need a break. We'll resume at 6:07 p.m. Okay. Just a 10 minutes break for everybody. Okay. And before that, I would like you to participate in a poll. How did you like the pace of the class? So please comment on the class pace. Was it fast? Was it as desired by you? Or is it slower than expected? Honest feedback. I don't know who's giving what response. So don't think as if I'll come to know by your response who is that one. Okay. Honest response before we go on a break. See, it's my first class with you. So I need to calibrate myself that, okay, I need to go fast or I need to go slow or I need to be with whatever pace I'm sticking to. Guys, vote. Fast. 5 seconds more. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Everybody. Some of you don't want to vote. Okay, never mind. Okay, so 60% of you has said the pace is as desired. 8 of you are saying it's fast. Okay, I'll try to slow down. Only 2 of you feel I'm slow. Okay. So people who are thinking I'm slow, please bear with me, right? It'll definitely increase to a certain extent in some time. Okay. So take a break. I'll mute myself and I'll shut off my camera also. Okay. Stop sharing. So now we're going towards quadratic polynomial graphs. That's very important. I'm sure you have been exposed to quadratic equations. In fact, quadratic polynomial also was in class 10, right? So we'll be now talking about quadratic polynomials. Polynomial graph. Okay. Now, how does a quadratic polynomial actually look like? So it's basically something which has got this kind of a structure, ax square plus bx plus c, okay, where your a, b, c are basically your real numbers. It may be complex also, right? There are quadratic equations. There are quadratic equations which has got complex numbers also as the coefficients, but we are not going to talk about them. I will wait for complex numbers chapters to take that up. For our graphing purpose, will assume ABC to be real numbers. Now, this ABC, A should not be zero. For the simple reason, if A is zero, it will become a linear polynomial. So why should I call it as a quadratic polynomial? So that distinction has to be maintained between linear and quadratic, and that's why A should not be zero. Now, something very, trivial, not for you to worried about. There are two types of quadratics that we normally talk about. One is called a pure quadratic. Okay. What's a pure quadratic? A pure quadratic is one where not only A is not zero, okay, but also B should be zero. So A should not be zero, but B should be zero. C may or may not be zero. Right? Example, something like x square minus 2. It's a pure quadratic. Okay, we'll be talking about pure quadratic in some of the chapters like integration next year. So we'll be learning how to integrate when there are pure quadratics in the denominator. Okay, this is just for your knowing purpose. There's nothing to be worried about. Oh, what's a pure quadratic? Should I do more research on it? No, just for your knowledge. Then there's something called adfected quadratic. Adfected. Not affected, adfected quadratic. Is those quadratic where A should not be zero and B also should not be zero essentially. Remember, in a quadratic, normally B and C could be zero, right? But in an adfected quadratic, A should not be zero and B also should not be zero. The word adfected means varying power of X. Okay. A A typical example could be something like x square minus 5x plus 6. This is an example of an affected quadratic. Okay. Yeah, C can be 0. C can be 0, but A and B both should not be 0 for affected quadratic. Okay, just for your information. So mostly we'll be talking about affected quadratic, but we'll start our discussion with the most basic of all quadratic. You cannot get a quadratic simpler than this guy. Y is equal to x square. Okay. And I'm sure you know the graph of this also. What is the graph of this? This graph is basically a graph which is a curve which we call as a parabola. This is a curve which we call as a parabola. Okay. Now again, pronunciation, please be watchful. I've seen people saying parabola and all those things. It's not like that. It's a parabola. Okay. What's a parabola? It's basically a path traced by an object when thrown under gravity. So let's say if this is a digital pen which I throw at you, this will come like this to you. Isn't it? Okay. So it'll make a path like this. Just like, you know, when Dhoni hits ball out of the cricket park, it takes a parabolic path. Okay. The launch of missiles, okay, most of them will be parabolic in nature, okay. Of course, there are some which go in a very, very straight line, but they will be parabolic in nature. So this is a parabola, and you can see the graph. It's basically having two arms, both are extending towards plus infinity. That's why I have shown them with arrow sign. It doesn't stop anywhere. So whenever you are plotting a parabola, make sure the end point you should put to arrows signifying that they are still moving upwards. Okay. What is this point called? Which I'm showing with a white dot. What is this point called? Anybody?
Origin.
Oh, that is origin for sure. What is that of a parabola? What is that called of a parabola? No.
Zero of the polynomial.
No. It is called the vertex of the parabola. Okay. Now it is at origin. Vertex is at origin, but we call that as the vertex. Okay. Now this is the most basic of quadratic graph that you can ever come across. That's why many times I call this as the skeleton graph for my quadratic. Now this skeleton word is my own coined word. Don't expect to see these words in your books. So why I call it as a skeleton graph? Because I'll be doing lot of experiments on it, just like we do experiments on skeleton in biolab. So now I'm going to take you to a tool which we call as the GeoGebra tool. Have you been exposed to GeoGebra tool? Anybody? Yes. Okay. So normally there are two graphing tools, my dear, which I would like you to download after this class. Okay. One is called GeoGebra. You can download it from GeoGebra.org. So you can just go to GeoGebra.org and download GeoGebra Classic 6. Now coming to resources, this is one of the very good resources that you can have for plotting things. If you're using your phone, this is for laptop primarily, laptop or desktop. Okay. If let's say you are using your phone, then I would recommend something called Desmos. I'll show you how it looks. I have it on my phone. I like plotting graphs a lot. I can't solve any question without plotting its graph. So almost 90% of the questions I solve, I plot the graph. Okay, so it will look like this. Okay, hope you can see on the screen. Okay. I'll just close it and reopen it once again. I'll show you the logo also. This is the logo. Okay, this is the logo. Desmos, you'll see. Okay, and then immediately the XY coordinate system will come. Hope you are able to see. Yes, Akshaj. Y equal to X square is a parabola. The graph, the structure is called a parabola. Okay, now where do you see parabola in your daily life? Can somebody tell me? Of course. The cricket.
Bases.
Huh?
Bases, containers.
Okay, you have some containers which are parabolic in nature. You'll see parabolic mirrors, headlights, correct. in your car, especially if you see those old Toyota cars, from the side you can see the mirrors are like this. Right? Nowadays, we don't use spherical mirrors. Those used to be in ambassador cars. Okay, probably your parents would have seen it. My dad used to have an ambassador car. So now spherical mirror is not used anymore because of the spherical aberrations. So we use parabolic mirrors nowadays. Okay. Now these mirrors have a characteristic. See, like this. There is a focus over here. Okay. This hand is focus. There's a bulb kept at the focus. When it hits the parabolic surface, it becomes parallel. That's why they're used for parabolic. So it is also used in operation theaters to, you know, kill stones in kidney. Okay. Let's say if I have a kidney stone, what we'll do, doctor will do, he'll place the mirror in such a way that the kidney is at its focus. Okay, there's something called focus also. I'll talk about it in the conic section chapter. And he will pass laser beam like this. It will hit the surface and pass through the focus, and it will kill my kidney stone. Yes. Please note one thing. There is an example which people normally cite that is wrong example. They say that if you hang a wire, okay, across two points, it takes the shape of a parabola. This is not a parabola. This is actually a catenary. Okay. So don't misuse these things. This is not a parabola. It may look like this, but it is actually a catenary. So if a wire of uniform mass per unit length is hung between two points, okay, the structure of the wire is actually a catenary, not a parabola. Hyperbola is something else. Hyperbola is, I'll show you in some time what is a hyperbola. Catenary is a cos hyperbolic function. Cosh. This is called a catenary. Okay, I'll show you on the graph. Meanwhile, let me take you to the graph. So I have plotted this. I've downloaded the tool on my system. So I'll directly open to the tool, GeoGebra tool. This is GeoGebra Classic 6. Okay. Is parabolic curve symmetrical? To Siddhant, to answer that question, yes, it is symmetrical about its axis. Okay, I'll tell you what is the axis. Yeah. So people who want to see a parabola, a typical parabola will look like this. Y is equal to, let's say, x square. Okay. This. Okay. This is a parabola. Here, this line is called the axis. So somebody was asking, what is the axis? So this line here, which is dividing the parabola into exact two parts, it's called the axis of the parabola. Okay. This point here is called the vertex of the parabola. Okay. In fact, I can show you on the tool itself. Your tool can easily show you the vertex of any conic. So just type ver. It'll show you one option. Click on that. It'll say which conic. So conic, this is the name of the function, f. So put f there. So it'll show you 0, 0. And it'll also show you by a. Okay. So a is the vertex of this parabola. Okay. You can say vertex to be the minimum most point of the parabola. In some case, when the parabola is upside down, let's say when your parabola is like this, I'm just drawing another version of a parabola. Let's say if your parabola is like this, then it can represent the maximum point of the parabola. So vertex is either, see, there are different types of parabola. You're right now seeing only two types. Your parabola can be like this also. Okay, that is called slightly tilted parabola. Your parabola can be like this also. Okay, there can be so many directions. So you can just think that where the axis is meeting the graph, that point is called the vertex. Okay. So it would be wrong to say that it is always the minimum or always the maximum. No, it is not like that. It's the point where the axis is meeting the parabola. That is the vertex point. Okay. Right now, my aim is not to tell you about parabola. I have a dedicated chapter to that in conics where I'll talk about it. Now, guys, I would like you to understand the difference between a catenary and a parabola. I'll show you the difference. What I'll do, I'll just add a one here. Okay. Just permit me to add a one. It'll go up. Okay. No worries. I'll come to that. Why it went up and all. I'll talk about that. Now I'll draw a catenary. Catenary is cosh. Cosh. Now cosh is a function. Okay. Which you'll see when the moment you type COS. you'll see cost share. You can see last, second last option. If you plot cost, see the difference. I'll move this graph slightly down. I'll zoom in also. Okay. Hope you're able to see the difference. Sorry, my figure is coming. My photo is coming in. Yeah. This graph that you see, which is green in color, this is what a wire will hang when it is hung between two points. Let's say I hang it about these two points. Okay. Let's say this is the ceiling for you. This wire will take this structure. So wire will hang like this. Wire hanging. This structure is what we call as catenary in the language of mathematics. Okay. It follows cos hyperbolic function. This is something which is called hyperbolic trigonometric function. I'll not discuss right about this right now. People who are willing to study about hyperbolic function, you will be discussed about this in pre-RMO and RMO sessions. Okay, I'll talk about it in that. Okay. So do you see the difference in the shape? Very similar, isn't it? They look very similar. But there is actually a difference. This is your parabola while this is your catenary. Okay. So please make a note of this, because I remember this very well, because they asked me in one of the maths quizzes. I went to represent my school in a maths quiz. So they asked me this question and I was surprised to know, I learned there that it was actually a catenary, not a parabola. Okay. Anyways, guys, this is not my discussion agenda today. I'm going to discuss with you simple parabola first of all. Before that, I'll just draw a normal parabola. Okay. Just a normal parabola. Y is equal to AX square plus BX plus C. Okay. Now, normally when you type such a thing in your GeoGebra, GeoGebra doesn't know A value, right? You're just typing A there, B there, C there. It doesn't know A, B, C, what value is it. So what it does, it self assumes some value. So it'll put some value. Let's say it has put 1, 1, 1 as of now. But at the same time, it will give you some liberty to change it. Okay. So it'll give you some range in which you can change your A and B values. Okay. So people who are first timers to this tool, I'm just telling you a bit about how it works. So you can vary it. Okay. You can change that limit also. For example, you may make it from minus 15 to 15 also. So let me change it. I can make it from minus 15 to 15 also. Okay. Now it is going from minus 15 to 15. Now, all of you, please put down your pens. I don't want you to have your pen in your hand also. Put it down. Okay. And listen to me what I'm saying. Listen to me what I'm saying. Very important thing. When you write the equation of a parabola like this, or equation of a quadratic polynomial like this, this is your leading coefficient, isn't it? This is your leading coefficient. Now, somebody was asking me, does leading coefficient always represent slope? No, it represents slope only for linear functions. For a quadratic function like this, it represents something very important, which we call as the concavity of the parabola. A here is responsible. I'm saying responsible for the concavity of the parabola. What does concavity mean? See, in this case, it is concave upwards. Do you see this? Okay. If the parabola was like this, let's say, hypothetically, let's say the six that Dhoni hits, it's a parabola which is concave downwards. Okay. Now, this guy A is responsible for that. Do you want to see how? If you change this A, the concavity of the parabola, not only upward and downward, it can change the breadth also of the parabola. Length and you can say the thickness and thinness of the parabola will also be governed by A. Okay, all of you see how. All of you see how. I'm just going to erase whatever I've shown on the board. I'm just going to take you to this particular slide. Now I'm going to vary my A. All of you please pay attention. Huh? This A I'm increasing. From 1 I'm increasing more. See, is it becoming thinner? That means A is influencing the concavity of this curve. Correct? So higher values of A, it is becoming more thinner. Can somebody tell me why? Why it is becoming thinner? Anybody? Unmute yourself and say. Anybody? Taniksha, Arjun, Madhav, Harikiran, sorry, Hariharan, Siddharth, Shashwat, Shreyas. Anybody would like to take a call? Gradient increase. Okay, let's not go to the gradient level. What does common sense say? Common sense will answer this, right? See, my teacher always used to say, first apply common sense, okay? Then comes knowledge. So common sense is something which God has blessed you with. It is a inherited knowledge. Then comes acquired knowledge, which the teachers give you. So first common sense, what does it say? Okay, see, common sense says, I'll take a very simple example. If I had y is equal to x square, okay? And if I had y equal to 2x square, okay? I'll draw both the graphs here, okay? Just roughly I'm drawing. So red one is y is equal to x square, okay? Now, at value of, let's say, 1 for x, y should also be 1. Right? So if you look at this, when x is 1, y should also be 1. Easy to calculate. Now for this guy, when x is 1, y should be 2, right? Correct? That means for the same value, I should hit the next graph, that is y is equal to 2x graph. Let me change my marker. Let me show it with some other color, blue color. I should be hitting up. At the same time, for every value, I should be going little up, right? Okay, for 2, this gives me 4, but this will give me 8. So for 2, it will come to 8. That means my graph should be looking like this. Okay, sorry for this, bad shape at the end. But roughly, you understand why it should be thinner. Because for the same value of 1, now I have to go and get a 2 value. And can only happen when my graph is more shrunk. In other words, when you have a quadratic, and you increase this value, y will also is going to increase for the same x. For the same x. Yes or no? If y is going to increase, that means for the same x coordinate, I have to go a higher value to meet my requirements. Are you getting my point? Yes or no? So let's say if I had y is equal to x square plus 3. And I have got y is equal to 2x square plus 3. At 0, let's say, it gives me the value of 3. Okay. For 1, it's, let's say, it gives me a value of 4. Okay. But the same guy for 1 will give me a value of 5. So I have to go higher. That's why the graph must be shrink. So higher positive values means my graph is going to become thinner and thinner and thinner. I'll come to BNC Anurag in some time. I'm just playing with A, my dear. B and C, I'm assuming they are not changing. Here in the graph, you would have seen I was just changing my A, not B and C. Okay. Right? Now, see something very interesting. So you saw that when I increased it from 1 to 15, this guy became thinner. Concavity reduced. Okay. If you go the other way around, that means if you decrease, it will become fatter. See, it's opening up, opening up, opening up, opening up, opening up. The moment I become zero, it becomes a straight line. Oh my God, did you see that? Sorry, I missed out that mark. Yeah, I can actually put the value also here. Okay. That means the quadratic equation has lost its parabolic property. It has become a straight line now. So see the transition. Okay, now see here. See my hands. High value of A, small, lesser, 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 still positive, huh? Still positive, but lesser, 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 lesser. The moment it becomes zero, it becomes a straight line. Now, continuing the trend, if you go negative, it becomes the other way around, that it becomes concave downward parabola. Why it happens like this? Again, let's reason it out. Very simple. See, when you had ax square plus bx plus c, and let's say this a was positive. This a was positive. If your x goes to infinity, what will happen to y? Please note, this term is much more heavier as compared to the other terms. So if I'm going towards infinity, this term is going even more towards a positive value. So y is also going towards infinity, correct? So this explains why, I'll just go back to the graph once again. This explains why when I was having a positive value of, when I was going towards infinity, y was also going towards plus infinity. Check it out. Okay. Now, even when you're going towards minus infinity, that means you're going towards this side. Since it is a square over here, and since this is positive, y will still go towards infinity. That means both the arms have to go up in the air. Correct? Right? Which means if my a is positive, my curve will always be opening upwards, that is concave upwards. Okay. Now see what will happen when my a is negative. If a is negative, as you go towards plus infinity, okay, this will even go towards plus infinity. This will also go towards plus infinity, but because there's a minus sign along with it, y will go towards minus infinity in this case. Getting my point? Even though the other terms may be positive, but this is a very heavy term which dominates the other two. Getting my point? So the leading coefficient is taking the lead. It is dictating terms to y. It is saying to y, boss, you will do whatever I tell you. If I am negative, you will go down negative. Are you getting my point? In the same way, if x is minus negative also, see, observe this graph. If it is a concave down, even if you're going towards plus infinity, y is going towards minus infinity. Even if you're going towards negative infinity, y is still going towards minus infinity. Because negative infinity square will still be positive infinity. Correct? And still minus sign is attached to it. That means it will ask it to go till again minus infinity. That's why it goes down. Both the hands of the graph goes down. Is this idea clear? Now, I have tried to explain you in a very layman language. Later on, I will introduce calculus to you. Basically, A is related to the double derivative of this function. But this is something which I'll take later on. Okay, don't worry about it. Okay, don't worry about calculus part. Okay. So as a teacher, I always want you to understand things like a layman, because you'll remember it for the rest of your life. Okay. I could use a lot of jargons, but that will not make, you know, your life easy, isn't it? Now, next thing is, A ka role to pata hai. What does A do? I know it now. Concavity decides the concavity. What does B do? If I change B, what do you expect the graph to do? Changing A, you know, shrinking, expanding, going towards negative, whatever. If I change my B, what will happen to this graph? So Harihiran is saying it will go to sideways. Anurag is saying it should shrink. Anybody else? Okay. Now you'll be very surprised to see what is happening actually. All of you, please focus on the vertex of this graph. Okay. It is actually going to perform dance. I'll show you how it dances. Okay. Focus on the vertex of this conic. Okay. Focus on it. Okay. In fact, I will on something called show trace. You can see here, if I click on the point, it will go to an option called show trace. Let's click on that. Show trace means, if I change my B, it will show what path A or the vertex is undergoing. Okay. So see here, I'm increasing my B, it's going down. I'm decreasing my A, it's going to the other side. Do you see that? What structure do you see? Let me increase the range of it. Let me make it 25 to 25. So you see that as you're changing your B, your vertex is dancing. It is dancing on what? It is dancing on another parabola. It is dancing on another parabola. No. Concavity is not decided. Yeah, it's dancing on a parabola which is concave downwards. But if I do the downward parabola, let's say I make the parabola down, and then I dance my B, then it will dance on an upward parabola. See here. You see that? Basically, it is dancing on a parabola which is of opposite concavity to it. Okay. Now, this I gave as a question to the 12th graders a few days ago, asking them to get the equation of this path traced by that, you know, vertex. Okay. If somebody is interested, you can find it out. As no problem. Wait for the right time to come. So, my dear, what is the conclusion here? The conclusion is, if you are varying your B, the vertex starts dancing. In fact, the parabola starts doing this. Okay. And this is dancing on a parabola. Okay. How many of you are aware of the coordinates of the vertex? If not, note it down. It's minus b by 2a, comma, minus d by 4a. Okay. What is d here? A, b, c, you can understand. What is d? D is actually the discriminant. I'm sure you would have heard about it in your quadratic equation chapter. Okay. So because now see the relation, why it is dancing. If you write it in proper way, it is actually something like this that you have written, isn't it? Let's say if you fix your A and you fix your C, that means A and C are fixed. A and C are fixed. And you are varying your B. You are varying your B. Then this varies and this varies. As a result, both the X and the Y coordinate of the vertex starts varying. Okay. That's why they start dancing. And they will dance in such a way that they will still be on a parabola. One of the Koramangala students of class 11th, I mean, same session I had with them, he actually gave me the equation the very next day. Okay. If you can do that, nothing like that, but I'm not putting a compulsion on you. Any question here? Any question here? How do you know him? Okay, yeah. Oh, he's in class with you. Okay, good. Oh, last year. Okay. Now, next is, how does C change? If C changes, how does the graph change? The C is just responsible for moving it up and down. Like this. Okay. See the C. For A and B here, if I just vary my C, see the graph is just moving up and down. See the motion of the vertex. Okay. So at whatever position it is just moving up and down. So now you know in a quadratic equation, what role these A, B, and C play. Okay. This is something which is very important for you to know. Again, I'm repeating. A decides concavity. B decides, or if you change B, it is going to move on a parabola. That means it is going to swing right to left, left to right, up to down, down to up. Okay? That means it's going to move like this. The parabola is going to swing like this. C just makes it go up or down. Yes or no? Okay. Now guys, what we are learning here is transformation along with it. Up till now, we have not discussed transformation. So now the first time I'll be talking about transformation. Now this graph, we have already seen. This graph, we have already seen y is equal to x squared. Now I would like you to tell me, what will happen to this graph if I, let me change the color. If I ask you to do y is equal to x minus 1 whole square, how would this graph change? Will it stay wherever it is, or will there be some small change in the graph? Please type privately to me, what is the change that the graph will experience? I'm waiting for a response. No, concavity will not change, Siddhant. A value has not changed, my dear. X square also has A1. X minus 1 whole square also, if you expand, A will be 1 there. So there's no change in the concavity. Okay, Akshay is saying it will go down. Anurag is also saying go down. Hariharan says move a little up and down. Aritra is saying move right by a unit. Madhav is also saying right by a unit. Vertex shifts up by one. Oh my God, so many types of answers. Good to see you all responding. Very good. Always keep interacting. Let it be wrong, guys. We are all learning here, right? I'm not making any kind of a judgment about your knowledge. Right? Now, whenever you're responding, you should actually do a bit of analysis. If I were to answer this question, I will do a small analysis. Okay, what analysis I will do? See, originally, the vertex is at 0, 0. Okay, that means when x is 0, y is also 0. But for this function to have y as 0, x should actually be 1. Isn't it? That means the 0 of this polynomial will now be 1. Earlier, the 0 of the polynomial was 0 itself. Correct? So what will happen? This vertex will move slightly right by one unit. So well done. Those people who said it will move right, you are absolutely correct. But there will be no change in the concavity as it does so. So every point starts moving 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 to the right, including the vertex. Do you see that? Okay. So this is the transformation which I want you to appreciate. Because you will not be able to draw all the graphs, right? You will not be able to plot all the graphs. But if you know the skeleton, and if you know what all transformations require me to reach it, then you can accordingly shift those graphs and make those changes to reach your final graph. See, Aksaj, let's say when x is 1 over here, what is the value of y? 1 only, correct? But to achieve the same 1, you have to put x value as 2. Are you getting my point? So let's say this one value to achieve the same thing, earlier it was achieved at 1, but now it will be achieved at 2. Correct? So it is like saying that this point has moved one unit to the right. Okay? Are you getting my point now, Akshaj? Okay. I show you on the tool itself. All of you please come to this tool. So let me erase all these unwanted things. So I'll reopen the graph. Okay, all of you please pay attention, huh? Now what I'll do is I'll plot y is equal to x minus k the whole square. Now again, since k I have not specified, this function will assume a value 1. Okay, so let's say I'll put it to 0. So now this is your x square graph. Hope you can see it. Okay, if you increase your k to 1, that means you make it x minus 1. See, it is starting to move right. Yes, it's basically the 0 of the polynomial is changing. Are you getting? So if you move it to 2, it will move 2 units to the right. So people who said it will move to the right by 1 unit, right? I can see most of you giving that answer to me. Absolutely correct. Okay. If you do the other way around, that means if you go towards, if you make it x plus 1, see it has gone 1 unit to the left. Now the vertex has come to minus 1, 0, this point. Okay, if you still move it, let's say plus 2, it has gone to the left again. Correct? So here, there is a rule which I want all of you to note down. The rule is, if the graph of y is equal to f of x, now why equal to f of x? Because this rule is universal rule. It is not that it is only applied to a parabola. It can be applied to straight lines, to conic, exponential functions, to logarithmic functions, to modulus functions. Whatever function you can make in your life, this rule is equally applied to all the functions. So what is this rule? Listen to this. The rule says, if there is a function y is equal to f of x whose graph is known to you, so tick mark means known to you, okay? And let's say if you want to achieve the graph of y is equal to x minus h, h being some positive quantity. So see what I'm doing. This is my f of x, think like that. Okay. Then this becomes f of x minus 1. Right? That means you're replacing your input from x to x minus 1. Correct. Then this graph will be nothing but the original graph shifted h units to the right. H unit towards right. See the arrow which I am facing. This is a universal rule. So if somebody says, hey, this is the graph of 2x plus 1. Can you tell me the graph of, I'm just giving a very simple example for you to relate. Can you give me the graph of y is equal to 2x minus 3 plus 1? You say, very easy, my dear. It is just going to move 3 units to the right. It'll come over here. Okay. So this transition is basically 3 units. Every point starts moving 3 units. Every point starts moving 3 units. Getting my point? See, h is a number, right? H is a number, x is a variable. X is a coordinate representation of any point on it. But h will be fixed. Getting the point, Tanishka? So don't get confused here. X represents any point's x coordinate. So it's a variable. If it is a variable, you cannot say it is greater than the variable because variable is still changing, right? Okay. So the agenda is very clear that if you're replacing your x with x plus h, the graph will move. Sorry, if you're replacing x with x minus h, the graph will move h units to the right, provided your h is positive. But if you're replacing it with x plus h, the graph will move h units to the left. H units to the left. Okay. Sir, what happens in x minus 2 whole square? Very good question. It'll move 2 units to the right. Correct? So I'll draw that. So if it is x minus 2, it will become like this. Okay. So this orange one is the graph of x minus 2 whole square. But does the square matter? There was already a square in the function, no? Akshesh, can you just unmute yourself and ask that question here?
Yes, sir. So, like over here, you have given the square is there, like even in this y is equal to f of x minus h. The square is already there.
Yeah. And this function can be anything. I'm just giving an example. In this case, it is x square. But tomorrow, it can be something like e to the power x also. It can be log x also. F of x means a generic name I'm given. Some function. That is what is the meaning of f of x.
Understood. Yeah.
Right. It doesn't mean f of x. There is no x square inside. It doesn't mean it's not a quadratic. F of x is a name. For example, student. Now, this student can be Aksaj also. This student can be Arnab also. This student can be Shashwat also. So, f of x is like a name given in general to any function, which has x as the variable in it. It doesn't mean x. If it is x square, I have to put x square here. No. It could be, I can call e to the power 5x also as f of x. Correct. F of x is just like a, you can say a name given to a function. Right? It can be anything, any function in this world. Is these two rules clear to you, all of you? Okay. If this is clear to you, I have a follow-up question to you. What will happen if I do this? Y minus 1 equal to x square. Okay. Let me first draw y is equal to x square for you. So let me just go back to my skeleton graph. See, I'm playing with my graph. That's why I call skeleton. So let's say this is x square. Okay, normally I will use the same pen color to represent the name here and the graph. Now tell me if I want x minus 1 the whole square, what will happen? What will happen to this graph? Hariharan says it will move up by 1 unit. Now, don't say just shift. Shift in which direction, Advik? Shift in which direction, Madhav? Hey, left, right, I already discussed with you. So, okay, if you're thinking it's still going to go at left and right, go ahead and write it. Okay, let me have a poll here. Question, what will happen to the graph? Option A, shift up by 1 unit. Okay. Option B, shift down by 1 unit. Option C, shift right by 1 unit. Option D, shift left by 1 unit. Okay, I'll run a poll. Just wait for me to run the poll. So here you go. Only one option is correct, okay? I'll give you 30 seconds to answer this. Time starts now. Everybody should answer, please. 30 seconds only. Five, four, three, two, one, go. End of poll. Just 19 of you voted. So I don't know why. So maximum people, that means Janta is saying option A. That is 54% of you. Then the next highest vote has gone to D. Okay, let's see what is the answer actually. So I'll stop the sharing of it. See, very common sense. Again, there's nothing above common sense. When I'm writing it like this, it means I'm doing y is equal to x square plus 1, isn't it? I just brought the 1 to the right side. Okay, now see the trend. Earlier when x was 0 here, again, let me change the pen color. Earlier when x was 0 here, y was also 0, right? But this time, my dear, when your x is 0, y is actually 1. That means the graph is now going, the vertex is going to take a jump by 1 unit. And if vertex is taking a jump, rest all of the points will also take a jump. That means every point will start moving up, up, up there. Every point will start getting a kick up by 1 unit. You get this point. Vertex is just an example. Okay. That means your graph will be appearing to be a parabola like this. And people who answered with option A, thumbs up to you. You are absolutely correct. Think a bit and reply, okay? So D and all, C and all, this is not going to happen, okay? Is that fine? Is my logic clear why it is moving up? So it is adding a 1 to every Y value which it was having in the previous graph. So every point is getting a kick. Up by 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, right? So they're all jumping up by 1. Let's say they are getting into an excited state, okay, of electrons, okay? So here comes another rule, my dear students, for you. The rule is, if you have been given the graph of a function, that means the graph of this function is known to you, tick mark, okay? Then the graph of y minus k, where k is some positive value, is equal to f of x will be the same graph kicked k units up. Okay. And if you have y plus k equal to f of x, then it is the same graph kicked k units down. Do you see that? Let me show you in GeoGebra. Okay. Now here what I'll do is, I'll remove this function. Now I'll go do y minus k is equal to x square. Again, they're going to assume some value of k. So they have kept it as 1. Okay, see, let me bring it to 0. So this was your original graph, right? So if you increase your k value, that means y minus 1, it'll go up by 1. Y minus 2, it'll go up by 2. Y minus 3, it'll go up by 3, like this. Similarly, if you go negative side, let me y plus 1 down. Y plus 2 down, y plus 3 down, like that. And This is applied to any function in this world, not only quadratic. You can apply it to any function in this world. Now, I'm going to ask you a few questions, which will be a mix of these two. That means I'll change X also for you, and I'll change Y also for you. And let's see who all are able to get those questions correct. So here comes the first question for you. Sketch is sketch. Sketch means a rough estimate. Okay. Sketch. Y minus 3 is equal to X plus 1 the whole square. Okay. And in that sketch, I want you to show me two things. The vertex coordinates and where it is cutting the y-axis. Your time starts now. Let's have 90 seconds for this. Time starts now. If you're done, type done. Okay. And then I'll put some options. You have to tick on those options. Okay. If you want to reply with your answer, you can reply privately, but don't put it for everyone to see. Okay. Okay. I can see answers coming from Hariharan, Sharvi, Shashwat, Aditya, cut set 4. Okay, so say 0, 4. Yeah. Okay. Guys, time up. Now it's time to vote. For vertex, please choose the options. Okay. Option 1, 1, 3. Sorry, option A. Option B, -1, -3. Option C, 1, -3. And option D. You pull it up. Option D, -1, 3. Your polling begins. Okay, 1 second. Yeah. Your polling begins now. Just 10 seconds to poll because you have already done it. Everybody, please press in the poll button for vertex. It didn't come.
Sir, I didn't get the poll.
Oh, one second. I'll relaunch it, dear. Now, is it coming?
No, sir.
Are you?
No, sir.
Them with the poll and the poll. Just a second. Now?
No, sir.
No. Okay, let it be. I think there is some problem with the poll. Okay, I'll just try one more.
We just got it and it just closed all of a sudden.
But those were the end results.
Yeah, those were the results. Now?
No, sir.
Ayo. Never mind. So which option do you think should be correct? Just type it out. Type it out for me. There is some issue with the poll. I'll get it resolved. Absolutely. Option D is correct. Okay, let's check how it happens. Let's check. Okay. Now, here comes a problem where I have given both the transformations together. Okay. Now, whenever you're trying to solve such question, even in the assignments that you will be getting, start from the skeleton graph. Okay. If you do your skeleton, if you take your skeleton graph and start making transformations, slowly you will reach your end goal. So let's say this is my skeleton graph. Y is equal to x squared. Okay. Now, which is the first transformation you want to do? Do you want to change x to x plus 1 or do you want to change y to y minus 3? Anything you can do, doesn't matter. End result will be the same. So let's say I change my y to y minus 3. Okay. Oh, let me write it in different ink. Let me write it in yellow. If you change y with y minus 3, then see what will happen. This graph is going to go 3 units up. Remember the rule. So it will become like this. Okay. Now, many people think that sir is changing the concavity of the graph. No, I'm not changing the concavity, dear. Concavity still remains the same as the previous, even though it may look a little bit, you know, thinner, but the concavity is not changing. Okay. Next transformation that you can do is the final transformation, which will bring you to the final result. Let's say you're changing x with x plus 1. So in this yellow graph now, you have to make the change. You have to make the change in this graph now. So in this yellow graph, you have to take it 1 unit to the left. Right? So your end result would look like this. Are you getting my point? And of course, it will cut the y-axis somewhere over here. So I'm just extending my y-axis. We'll come to that a little later on. But meanwhile, what has happened to the vertex? Vertex has gone 3 up, 1 left. 3 up, 1 left. Where will it reach? Minus 1, 3. So option D is correct. Are you getting my point? And where is the y-intercept? It is very easy. Just put x as 0 to get the y-intercept. So y minus 3 is equal to 1 square. That means y is equal to 4. So this point is 0, 4. Any questions here? See, simple trick is minus means right and up. Okay. It goes ulta, I know that, because minus our brain thinks left and down, right? But actually what is happening, I'll tell you the inside story. It's actually not the graph which is moving. It is the origin which is moving. But I don't want you to think like that, because if you do, you'll get confused. Okay. So just have a image in my mind that if I'm changing my x with x minus something, I have to go right. If I'm changing my y with y minus some positive number, I have to go up. And reverse will be the opposite direction. So x plus something, go left. y plus something, go down. That's the way I can recommend shares for you to remember. Yeah, you can say that it's following the opposite sign. Okay. Now, you would be very lucky if you have to get a question like this in the exam. This is like telling you the transformation bluntly. Okay. Where to go? Normally, the question will be somewhat like this. Y is equal to x square minus 6x plus 5. Like that, they'll give you this question. Can you all sketch this graph and tell me where is the vertex and the y-intercept? So please sketch it, number one. Number two, tell me the coordinates of the vertex. And number three, tell me the y-intercept. Fast. Can we have just 1 minute to do this? Because you already know. Okay, let's have 1.5 minutes. Any question, anybody? Yeah, I can see people asking questions. Take positive and negative. Yeah, Charan, that you can do that. Yeah, sure, Madhav. We'll do more questions so that the concept sinks in. In case you by mistake drop out of the session, you can click on the same link to join back again. So don't panic if your internet has gone off for some time. It has happened with me so many times that my internet only has gone off. So you can click on the link and get back. In case there's a power cut, see, these technical issues will happen, right? It's all beyond our hands. So don't get panicked. And recording is always on. Okay, I'm getting answers now from Akshaj. From Hariharan also I got. Okay. Okay. Okay, last 20 seconds, then we'll start the discussion. Guys, in the group also, if you have any doubt, please ask on the group itself, okay? That group is also meant for, you know, clearing your doubts. Don't think like that. The group is only meant for, sirs to send their timetable and schedule. You can also post your questions and everybody, please try to answer everybody's question, okay? Help others. If you help others, God will help you. Yeah. So see, this is not in the format which we would have liked it to be in. Okay. I would actually like to see this in this format. Y plus minus K and X plus minus some H whole square, right? This is the format in which I would like it to see, right? Because then only I would be able to decide whether to, how much to go right or left or how much to go up and down. Okay. So what I'll do in order to bring it to this form, what do I have to do? I have to complete the square. I have to complete the square. Now I'm assuming everybody here has done this exercise of completing the square so many times in your life. Okay. So now I will do the completion of squares here. That's a very simple. What I'm going to do is I'm going to write the first two terms. So see how it works. People who have not done completion of squares before or not very confident about it, please see. See, what do we do is we make the coefficient of x square directly or indirectly as 1. So in this case, you don't have to worry. It is already 1. Okay. Then take this number along with the sign. Half it. What is half of minus 6? Minus 3. Correct. So what I'll do x minus 3 whole square. Okay. Basically what I'm doing, I'm treating it as minus 2ax. Okay. This is x square minus 2ax like that. So I should have a minus a over here, right? So now when you expand it, you realize that x minus 3 whole square will give you x square minus 6x, but it'll give you 9 also, right? But 9, I don't want. 9, I don't want. So I remove the 9. Okay. And bring this 5 down over here. So it actually becomes y is equal to x minus 3 whole square minus 4. Isn't it? So far, so good. Okay. Which actually tells me that it was a case of this. And now looking at it, the transformation is very clear. What is the image coming to your mind? 3 units right, 4 units down. Isn't it? So it is very easy thereafter to imagine. So let me start with the skeleton graph. Y is equal to x square, which is like this yellow graph. Okay. Now, which transformation you want to do, it's your call. So I would, let's say this time for a change, I will do x minus 3 whole square first. Now, people were asking, sir, how do you remember? Minus means right. So I'll draw it right by 3 units. So somewhat like this. Okay. Without any change in the concavity. Okay. So now I'm at 3, 0. And now the final nail in the coffin, I have to do y plus 4 is equal to x minus 3 whole square. That means it'll go 4 units down. So this guy will reach this. Okay. Now, here also, please be very, very careful while sketching it because many of us will choose a wrong y-intercept. So please understand, y-intercept is obtained by putting x as 0. So y will give you 9 minus 4, which is 5. So it'll cut at somewhere 5, 0. So come down like this. Okay. That's the best way to sketch it. Okay. So cutting it at 0, 5, and this point is 3, -4, that is your vertex. Is that fine, everybody? Okay, let's see who all got the right answer. Very good, Charan, Arnav, Swaraj, now you got it, dear. Now you got how it works. Any question now? I'll stop here. and take your questions first. Then I'll go to the next question. Vedha, clear? Please ask. Please ask if you have any kind of a question here. Okay. Now, before we move on to another question, there is one small thing which I would like to do. In fact, I would like to ask you this question. Okay, I'll start with a very simple graph. Y is equal to 2x plus 3. Okay, we all know this graph. Okay, straight line graph having a slope of 2 and having a y-intercept of 3. So somewhat like this, it will appear. Yeah. Okay, so let's say this point is 0, 3. Both sides it is extending indefinitely. Okay, now my question is, what will happen if I change the sign of x to minus x? I mean, I'm asking you, what is the relationship between the graph of these two? I know you can plot both of them. So I'll only plot it for you. So no need for you to plot. So the graph will look like this, isn't it? Okay. Can somebody tell me how are these two graphs related? What is the geometrical? Yeah, of course, negative slope. Is there any kind of reflection happening of yellow graph? Absolutely. It flips about the y-axis. Right? So basically what is happening, these two are like mirror images. These two are like mirror images treating the mirror as your y-axis. So think that the y-axis is like a mirror. Okay? So the point is getting reflected about, every point here is getting reflected about this mirror. So this point A is coming to this point, A dash. This point B is coming to B dash. Like that, every point is undergoing reflection. Are you getting my point? So what I want you to understand here, boys and girls, listen to this carefully. In any function, this is a rule which I would like you to note down. If your function graph is known to you, and somebody comes and says, draw me this function graph, all you need to do is reflect the above graph about the y-axis. About the y-axis. Getting my point? So I'll just give you a hypothetical case. Okay. Let's say there was a graph like this. Okay. Just hypothetically some graph I have drawn. Okay. This is the graph of some function, y is equal to f of x. Now, which function is that? Even I don't know. Okay, I've just drawn the graph. And let's say somebody says, give me the graph of y is equal to f of negative x. What are you going to do? You are just going to reflect this graph about y-axis, treating it as a double mirror. That means both the sides are silvered. So this triangle is going to go like this. And this, you can say, a sine curve is going to come like this. Simple as that. Getting my point? This rule is a very important rule. In a similar way, if somebody says, what is the graph of minus y is equal to f of x? Now he's changing the sign of y. What will you do in that case? Any idea? Anybody? Anybody can take a guess? It's not minus x plus 1, Madhav. It is just y is equal to f of minus x. Absolutely, Advik, brilliant, Hariharan, very good, Shashwat. It is going to reflect about the x-axis. Okay, why it happens is very simple. It is not a rocket science. I'm just going by the logic. Okay, what is the logic? Logic is, when you are changing the sign of x, so let's say there was a point 1, 2. If I just say change the sign of x coordinate, where will it go? Where will it go? Minus 1, 2, correct? Isn't it? So minus 1, 2, if it from 1, 2, if it becomes minus 1, 2, isn't it getting reflected about the y-axis as the mirror? That is what is happening in the first. If I say change the sign of y, won't this point become 1, -2, my dear? That means it will come directly below it in reflected about the x-axis. This is the reason for this particular change. That's it. Common sense prevails. Getting my point. So I have a question. I'm so sorry. I pressed on the long. So I have a question. If I say plot the graph of 3 minus y is equal to, let's say, x plus 2 whole square, how will you plot it? So this is the next question for you. Sketch this graph. And secondly, please tell me the coordinates of the vertex. And please tell me the y-intercept. Let's see. Fast. 90 seconds for this. Let it be wrong. I understand you're the first time you're doing this type of concept. Okay. I'm not saying right or wrong, Hariharan. Noted your answer. Let's see what others have to say. I hope you have drawn the sketch also, okay? Just don't mention the vertex and keep quiet. Draw the sketch also. And guys, one more thing. You now have both the graphing tools at your disposal. That doesn't mean you will solve your assignment questions by using them, right? Please have a honest learning. That is very important. Honesty is the most important thing while you are learning something. Okay. Please don't try to impress anybody by using those tools. Your learning is important. Making mistake is a ingredient, you can say important ingredient of learning. So verify your answer by those tools. Don't solve your question by those tools. Okay, Shashwat, Sharvi, Shreyas also, very good. Anurag, see, I'm not saying right or wrong to your answer, dear. I'm just happy that you're responding. I just want that as of now. First class, I'm not expecting miracles from you. Okay, guys, 20 seconds more. Please wrap this up so that I can discuss it. Okay. So I really got a very good response from everybody. Hats off. I'm very glad to see everybody answering. It's a different thing whether it's right or wrong, but initially you have to take this leap. I know accuracy is important, but as of now, your responding is important for me. Now see, how will I attack this question? Okay. First of all, what is the skeleton graph that we are going to look at? So I'm going to start with x square. Okay. So I'm going to draw it step by step. So let's say x square graph, y is equal to x square graph is a parabola like this. Okay. Now, next transformation that I would do is I will make x as x plus 2. Oh, sorry. Let me change the ink. I don't want to write with the same ink. So I'll change x with x plus 2. That means I'm shifting the graph 2 units to the left. So it will be appearing like this. Okay. So this point is minus 2 comma 0. Okay. Now I'm going to change sine of y because I have to get here. Okay. So now see, I'll change my pen color again. Let me take green. So minus y is equal to x plus 2 whole square. My changing the sign of y means what, my dear? Reflecting about x axis. See, there's a rhyming thing. Change the sign of x means reflection about y. Change the sign of y means reflection about x. Again, change the sign of y, reflection about x. Change the sign of x, reflection about y. Okay. So if you reflect it about the x axis, it's going to look like this. Is that fine? Now, many people ask me, sir, now how are you going to fit this 3 over here? How are you going to put this 3 over here? Never mind, I'm going to still do it. I'm going to replace my y with now y minus 3. Okay? If I do that, that means I'm shifting this graph 3 units up. Okay? So my final answer would look like this. like this. Getting my point? So this should be a final graph with the vertex position at minus 2 comma 3. So those who said minus 2 comma 3, absolutely correct. See, I've got my final answer, final expression which I needed. Okay, I'll also verify this on the GeoGebra tool. Now coming to y-intercept. For y-intercept, we all know, put x as 0. So when you put x as 0 over here, it gives you 3 minus y is equal to 4. So y is equal to minus 1. So yes, this point is going to be 0 comma minus 1. Why you mirrored? Okay, so Tanishka, I mirrored because from here I was replacing my sign of y to be minus y. Remember what did I discuss in the rule? If you change the sign of y, you have to reflect the graph about x-axis. That's why I reflected it. I'm just following the rule. Are you convinced? Okay. Yeah, see, Tanishka's question was, why did I reflect the graph from this white to green? Because I was changing from y to minus y. If I'm changing from y to minus y, why the change in sign? See, ultimately, I have to achieve this, my dear. No, this is my end goal. I have to reach this position. So doesn't it require minus y here? If you don't do it, then you will always be getting y plus minus something. So y will not become minus y ever, no? How else do I change it minus? How else do I change y to minus y? Tell me some other way to do it. I'll do that only. There's no other way. Okay. Yeah. Now people are asking, why did you change it to y minus 3? Because I had the end vision in my mind that I have to get a plus 3. So if I would have written y plus 3 with a negative outside, see here, had I written, see, I had already achieved this goal, right? If I do y plus 3 and when I expand it, I would have got minus y minus 3 is equal to x plus 2 whole square. But is this what I need? No, right? I need this. So I have an end goal in my mind and according to that, I'm making the transformation. It's not a blind thing that I'm doing. Okay, let's put minus 3, you know, let's put plus 3, let's do plus 2. No, I have this end goal. This is my end goal. Okay, and I'm working according to that end goal. Getting my point? Okay, can you just verify this? 3 minus y is equal to x plus 2 whole square. Let me verify this on the Desmos, on the GeoGebra tool. Sorry for speaking Desmos every time because I normally use my phone for plotting it. So 3 minus y is equal to x plus 2 the whole square. Ayyo Rama, what happened? Bracket I missed out. Yeah, see this. I can also show you the vertex of this equation 1. See, minus 2 comma 3. Okay, this is what we got. Vertex minus 2 comma 3. See, minus 2 comma 3. Blue graph is what is my answer. Check the blue graph. This blue graph. Okay. It happens, Sharon. Don't worry. Initial few classes, you'll be like, you know, going mad. When to reflect, when to, you know, take the mirror image. It will happen. Okay. Let time take its own course. Did you like it? Can we end the problem with a positive note? One question will you like to try? Okay. See, I didn't get enough time to expose you. This is a very, very long chapter. I wanted to expose you to so many graphs. Okay. One last question I'll take. Sketch the graph of. This time I'll give you it in a slightly different way. Let's say 3 plus 8x minus x square. And I would like you to show me the number 1 vertex and number 2 the y-intercept. Okay, time starts now. Let's have 90 seconds for this. Time starts now. Oh, Hariharan. Last question. After that, I'll stop. Yes, Suraj, please ask. What's your doubt here? You can unmute yourself. You can talk. Rather than typing it out, please ask. This is not a very big batch. This is a batch of 25, 26 students. Yeah. You can unmute yourself and talk. How do you find the vertex? On GeoGebra, you are asking?
No, sir.
On the graph itself?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, wherever was the original vertex, I keep applying the transformation and see where does that point reach. That point becomes your vertex. Okay. If you're asking in general how to find vertex, you'll have to wait till I do quadratic equations with you.
Okay, sir.
Okay. If you want a vertex formula directly, but don't use it right now, it's minus b by 2a, comma minus d by 4a. I had already given this formula while I was explaining how does the parabola jump when your b is changing, right? So this is the direct coordinate of the vertex. You can use this as a verification also. Okay, time up. Let's discuss. Time up. Let's discuss. See, again, this is not in the format which I would like it to be in, right? I don't like this format because it doesn't give us any idea about in what direction and how much the shifting is happening. So again, complete the square. How do I complete the square? See, there's a way to do that also. So if you see, x square has a coefficient of minus 1, right? So take it common from these two terms like this. Okay. Now half this. Half of that is minus 4. So write x minus 4 whole square. But remember, when you are writing, we'll discuss earlier. When you're writing x minus 4 whole square, you will generate x square, you'll generate minus 8x, but you'll also generate plus 16. But plus 16 beta, I don't want. Correct? So I'll remove it. Now I'll again reopen the brackets and it'll become 19 minus x minus 4 whole square. Am I right? Which actually means y minus 19 as negative x minus 4 whole square. Now this is the desired form. This is the desired form. And I can apply my transformations here. All of you, please watch how I'm doing this transformation. So I'm going to first draw my skeleton graph. What is my skeleton graph? Y is equal to x squared. So that's going to be like this. Tuck, tuck, tuck. Correct. Is that fine? Now, what do you want to do next? What do you want to do next? Let us change the sign of y itself. Okay. You will be surprised why I'm doing that. Let's change the sign of y. Okay, see, whatever approach you take, ultimately the end goal must be achieved. See, there can be so many paths. Okay, if you change the sign of y, you have to reflect this about the x-axis. So basically the graph will now look like this. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to send this minus sign on the other side. See, like this. Will the graph change? Will the graph change? No, right? Because the equation is not changing. I'm just sending the minus sign to the other side. Okay. Now next, what I'll do, I'll replace my x with, let me choose green color. Oh no, brown color. Let me replace my x with x minus 4. So minus is already there. Now I made x minus 4. That means this guy, white guy, will shift 4 units to the right. So it'll become like this. Okay. So this vertex now has gone to 4 comma 0. Understood? Any question here? Any question here? No question? Okay. Now again, I'm going to make a final change. I'm going to put y as y minus 19 and everything will remain the same. That means this green guy will now go up by 19. This will go up by 19. Getting my point? So if this goes up by 19, it will appear to be, I'm just drawing a rough structure. It will appear to be like this parabola. Okay. Sorry for this coming in between. So this point will now be 4 comma 19. This will be 4 comma 19 and y-intercept will be 0 comma 3. Check it out. Okay. So this is going to be your final graph. Who all got it correct? Give yourself a pat on the back. I'll also verify this on the tool. 3 plus 8x minus x squared. 3 plus 8x minus x square, 3 plus 8x minus x square, 3 plus 8x minus x square. Three plus 8x minus x square. Oh, see, we are absolutely correct. Okay, and I'll also show you the vertex position, vertex of this. Yeah, 4,19, you can see here, 4,19. Okay, so boys and girls, I'm going to stop over here. Okay.